Okay, and so.
Members, it's time, and we have now a quorum. Can we invite the administration to join us, please? If I may remind members, we need three members, including myself, to form a quorum.
大家有冇嘢需要?
Members, do you need to declare interest? No, thank you. Sorry, speaker did not come through. Secretary, welcome to you and your team. I won't introduce each of your colleagues. Anyway, welcome to this hearing, which is a public hearing of the PAC. Now, I think we could get started. First, the legal advisor. Can you please explain to us which ordinances are relevant to Chapter 4 of Report Number 75? And then I'll invite the Director of Audit to give us a short introduction. And then the Secretary for Home Affairs has also tabled a speech, which is Gen 4. Legal Advisor, please. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. For today's chapter, that is chapter 2 of the audit report number 75, or chapter 4 rather, of report number 75, members, you could refer to CAP 344, that is a building management ordinance. It provides a legal framework for owners to form owners' corporations. And then they could perform the duties in managing the building. Well, it's stated clearly in an ordinance on the method of formation of the OC, the powers of the OC, and the monitoring mechanism. So this is by way of brief information to members. Thank you. Thank you. Director of Audit, please. Chapter 4, actually. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for inviting me to give a brief introduction on Chapter 4. Of the audit report number 75, that is efforts of the Home Affairs Department in facilitating building management. There are four parts to the report. Part one, introduction. It gives a background to this audit exercise. For the management of the common parts of private buildings, this is the shared responsibility of building owners. The Home Affairs Department is responsible for implementing government policy through various supporting services. The department would help owners of private buildings to form owners' corporations and manage the building management and so on. Part 2, support services for the formation of owners' corporations. As at the end of 2019, there are about 5,255 private buildings without owners' corporations or any form of residence organizations. And these buildings have not engaged any property management companies. These buildings are generally referred to as the free new buildings. Since 2011, the Home Affairs Department has engaged contractors to carry out two schemes. That is the Building Management Professional Advisory Service Scheme, BM Pass, and the Residence Liaison Ambassador Scheme, RLA Scheme. So they're responsible for... So with these two schemes, owners without... the free new buildings will be assisted with the formation of owners' corporations and improve the management of the buildings. Now this... the BM Pass covers... also covers buildings which have formed owners' corporations, but whose management committees have become defunct or inactive. And then the service does not cover buildings for which owners' corporations cannot be formed in accordance with CAP 344, such as a private building with single ownership. the audit finds that the Home Affairs Department does not have record of information on the number of such buildings. So it's hard to ascertain how many eligible buildings there are under the BM Plus. As at March 2020, some 3,822 buildings were approached, 536 owners' corporations were formed or resumed. So the overall success rate is 40%. As for the Resident Liaison Ambassador Scheme, between 2015 and 2019, the recruitment rate of RLA has dropped by 24%. As for three new buildings aged 30 years or above, only 22 to 35% of these buildings have a resident liaison ambassador. Part 3 of the report is on support services on other building management matters. At the 18 district offices, the HAD has set up the district building management liaison teams. These teams are formed by liaison officers. They provide support services to building management matters. On pre-meeting advisory service for OCs, the audits found that the Home Affairs Department does not keep proper records of the services provided. And then between 2016 and 2019, the requirement as stated in the operational manual on building management for liaison officers of visiting each building at least once a year cannot be reached. Every year, about 47 to 54% of the buildings have not been visited. For some buildings, there's been no visit in the past 5 years. And then there are other buildings that have been visited several times in the same year. But then the liaison team has not made contact with relevant OCs. On training on building management for liaison officers, the audit found that between 2015 to 16 and 2019 to 20, the attendance rate number has dropped from 329 to 232, which is a percentage of 40%. Part 4 is on other administration. Now for the performance indicators in the controller officer's report on liaison with owners, management bodies of private buildings, the HAD has set target numbers of liaison for each of the 18 DOs and for the headquarters on the support services. The audit found that 14 DOs and headquarters did not meet the targets in 2019. And of the 18 DOs, 9 of them, or 39% has persistently failed to achieve their allocated targets for 3 consecutive years from 2017 to 2019. And on educational and publicity programs, there are also performance indicators. There's room actually for improvement in counting attendance or in counting the number of programs. For example, the HAD headquarters DOs have double counted the same programs, and for a television advertisement broadcast during a 6-day period was counted as 60 programs. And also there's need to update the data in the database of private buildings, such as the number of buildings, the date of the buildings were completed, and so on. So this information will be useful for the HAD to plan and carry out various services. As at the 31st of March 2020, there are about 40,000 buildings kept in the database. The audit found that some of the information has not been updated. For example, about 7,000 buildings, or 70% of the total, does not include the year-built data. That's why on this basis, the audit has made recommendations on improvement measures. These measures have been accepted by the Home Affairs Department. Here, I would like to take the opportunity to thank the Home Affairs Department staff for their full cooperation, notwithstanding the COVID-19 epidemic during our audit exercise. Thank you.
I thank the Director of Audits for his presentation. Now, I will invite the Director of Home Affairs to give us a presentation. or the Secretary for Home Affairs. Members and Chair, I would like to thank the Audit Commission to conduct the value for money review and provided many valuable views concerning our efforts to facilitate building management. Before moving on to the content, I would like to explain our role in terms of building management. Managing private building is the obligation of the owners. The government's policy is to facilitate their work. Through many measures, we have encouraged and assist the owners to incorporate different owners' organizations, including providing a legal framework under the Building Management Ordinance, BMO Cap 344, to facilitate the incorporation of owners to discharge the duty to manage the building. Besides that, the HAD has also provided a lot of support services for owners to help them manage their building effectively. Since 2011, we have rolled out different measures. The new measures include free legal advice service for building management and owners' corporations advisory service scheme, and also dispute resolution services, including building management dispute advisory services and the trial scheme of free outreach legal advice service on building management. Concerning old buildings, we have set up the central platform for building management and also the CCF subsidy scheme for OCs of old buildings. Part 2 of the audit report review our work on supporting 3 new buildings. They are buildings which do not have OCs or any form of residence organizations nor engage any property management companies, PMC. We understand that the society is very concerned about management of 3 new buildings. We have been providing support through BMPAS, that is the Building Management Professional Advisory Services Scheme, to assist incorporation of owners' corporation in 3 new buildings so that the owners have a platform to discharge their building management duty and promote good building management. With our work, the number of 3 new buildings has been on the decrease. In 2011, there were 6,600 free new buildings. As at the end of 2020, we only had 4,900 such buildings. The decrease is 25% in 10 years. Besides incorporation of OCs, we have been assisting management of free new buildings through other ways. For example, we have mutual aid committees and also owners' organizations and also resident society and so on. For buildings where owners' corporation cannot be incorporated, they have hired property management companies to help running their building. Some 10% about 4,000 of such buildings have engaged PMC services. According to the audit report, there are still a lot of problems, including inherent problems and also limitations to 3 new buildings. In the report, it is mentioned that a lot of remaining buildings which do not have any management at there are some characteristics. For example, most of the residents are tenants rather than landlords, or there are more elderly people living in the building so that they are less willing to set up owners' corporation, or there may be multiple DMCs, or the building is under acquisition, so OCs cannot be established. So it is very difficult for 3 new buildings to establish OCs. However, we will accept the audit report's recommendations and we will consolidate the experience and provide and regularize some support programs to support 3 new buildings to manage the building through different ways, for example, setting up OCs. Besides that, there are also fire hazard, environmental issues, and structural safety. To deal with these issues, we cannot just rely on OCs. These problems are not just limited to 3 new buildings. Even for buildings with OCs, they still have these issues. That's why we have been working together with the owners and tenants, as well as different bureaus and departments, to solve these problems. Take fire safety issues, for example. To enhance fire safety of old buildings, the chief executive has indicated that the government would consider amending the Fire Safety Buildings Ordinance to empower the fire services departments and the buildings departments to commission fire safety improvement projects for owners in old buildings who are not capable to do so themselves, and charges will be recovered from them afterwards. And also, the budget has announced that $10 billion will be set aside for the Urban Renewal Authority to engage in a subsidy plan for maintaining drainage pipe system in old buildings with lower rateable value. We can see that for issues like fire safety, structural safety, environmental issues, we rely on relevant departments to enforce the law and to provide targeted financial and technical support to the owners. The HAD will continue to take the role of facilitator to provide supporting and referral services for owners. According to the recommendation involving the in regard of the recommendations in part 3 and part 4 of the audit report, we have been following them up. For example, the report suggested that we use electronic means to carry out briefing for the central platform on building management. We have live streamed the briefing held in Yuen Long in December 2020, and we will make use of the same method in the future. And also, we have taken up the recommendation in the report to update the guidelines in the district building for the district building management liaison teams at the DBMLTs. And also, in the guideline, we have requested the liaison officers to fill in reports after visiting, and also to make a record whether the database for private buildings should be updated. We will make references to the recommendations in the audit report and perfect the measures, and we are happy to take members' questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Secretary. Mr. Lau and the Deputy Chairman are the lead members asking questions today. First, we'll start with Mr. Lau. You have 30 minutes. After that, Deputy Chairman, anytime you want to, you know, come in, just raise your hand. So we allow some flexibility here. Thank you. Because Mr. Lau is the lead member for the first time. So welcome to you for joining the PAC. So we will give you all the support you need. Maybe you could put your questions section by section. Do you want to ask questions first about the report, or do you have questions about the secretary's speech? So you could choose to start with questions on the speech of the secretary. Or you could choose to start your questions on the chapter. Well, actually, I will include my questions on the speech in my questions on the chapter, because the secretary was just responding to the chapter. So please get started then. Thank you. I'd like to thank the Audit Commission for the hard work in carrying out this audit exercise, as they provided many figures. Now, from this report, we can see how much the government has done in providing support services and how effective these services have been. Now, there are many buildings under the scope of CAP 344. There are many buildings in Hong Kong. Some have set up OC, some have not. They are all covered by this ordinance. But of course, the Audit Commission audit is focused on the three new buildings and ways to promote the formation of OCs for three new buildings. The Secretary explained the difficulties faced in helping building owners form OCs. I will come to that later. Perhaps I'll start with section 2, because section 1 is on introduction. Some house rules, house matters first. Mr. Zhang, welcome to the PC. If you have any questions, since you're not a member of the PAC, you could ask the Deputy Chairman to raise questions on your behalf, okay? Sorry, Mr. Lau, sorry. Please, you can start now.
Thank you. Now first, I will ask a question about paragraph 2.2. Assisting owners of aged buildings to form OCs, there have been three phases of BM Pass support. It includes house-to-house, door-to-door visits, and also recruiting residence liaison officers, and also providing advisory services to OCs. So before the formation of OCs, besides recruiting residence liaison officers, would you help these owners to fill in forms to apply for subsidies or take out third-party risk insurance plans? Which paragraph again, Mr. Lau? Paragraph 2.2. Secretary, please. Thank you, Chair. We have been commissioning legal consultants to reach out to owners in three new buildings. So besides door-to-door visits and arranging meetings for them, when owners are faced with difficulties, we would advise them to establish owners' organizations, for example, OCs and management committee to address the problems. And also, we have been helping the owners to understand what schemes can be applied to address different issues, for example, fire safety and structural safety. I will invite the Director of Home Affairs to supplement. Ms. Janice Jie. Our consultancy service is to help the OCs to apply for subsidies and support. For example, building maintenance and so on. These schemes are only open for the application of OCs. So we encourage the owners to set up a OCs, and then we would help them to get the relevant subsidies. The incentive for the owners to form OCs include structural problems of the buildings. They have to repair the building, so we would help them to do so and to apply for the relevant schemes. Mr. Lau, I'm concerned that some owners may have received such consultancy services for a long time, but still no owners' corporation is established. Well, this service is a very good idea. However, would it encourage the owners to enjoy these services without establishing their own OCs? It seems that there is not enough incentive for them to establish AOC, because that would be a body corporate and there would be a lot of legal responsibilities involved, and also additional costs will be involved. So I think the BM Pass is a good idea. However, there are people who refuse to set up their own OCs and enjoy the service. It seems that you might be encouraging people to do that, Ms. Che. Yes, we understand that. Even if they have our consultancy service, there are schemes which require a legal capacity or legal entity for application. For example, to commission a contractor and so on. So the owners have to form an OC to do that. For work that can be done without the capacity of a OC, the legal advisor would help them to do those parts first. However, for a lot of things, you need to form a OC to deal with those issues. Otherwise, those issues cannot be addressed. Now, we have the legal advisory services available. However, in the long run, it is more desirable to set up an OC. Secretary, concerning whether it would discourage them to form an OC, I don't think so. Concerning the fire safety, structural safety, and the environment of the building, well, all owners will have to bear the legal responsibility if there is concrete spalling and someone is injured. So we have been providing briefings to owners and help them understand that by establishing an OC, they can better manage the safety of the building that they are living in, rather than ignoring it. So we have been providing different incentives and financial and technical support to owners. These schemes are only open for application by OCs. Well, if it is technical support that the owners need, we will give them. So if it is money that they need, we will provide them with financial support. The government is taking an extra step to help the owners to better manage their building. It is definitely better than not managing the building at all. Secretary, it seems that you haven't directly answered Mr. Lau's question. The BM Pass from 2011 till now, we have had three phases of BM Pass. $150 million have been spent on it. Do you think it is a success? In the Secretary's opening remark, the number of free new buildings have decreased from 6,000 to 4,000. So on the from the point of view of value for money, it seems that you have spent $150 million to decrease the number of free new buildings by 2000. So it seems that the success rate is quite low in the past decade. Are you going to continue with the BM Pass? It seems that you are spending public money, but not achieving much. And also in terms of the improvements on health and safety, the objective of having the BM Pass in 2011 was not achieved. So can you explain that to us, Director? Thank you, Chair. We fully understand that there are certain difficulties for free new buildings to establish OCs. The reason why they are free new buildings is because they lack any form of owner organizations. They share some characteristics. For example, they are very old, and also, the owners are quite old. They are usually Chinese tenement building. Because of the advanced age of the owners, they usually don't have the ability to form OCs on their own. We have the BM Pass since 2011. That is to help owners who are not able to form OCs to manage the building better. The BM Pass has helped certain buildings to establish OCs. However, after some time, the properties have changed hands and some owners have left the building. That's why the OCs became inactive. That's why we are providing other incentives that we have mentioned. When inspection or maintenance need to be done, owners need to apply for a subsidy in the capacity of OCs. In this regard, BM Pass really helped the owners. Not only were OCs established, maintenance work and the mandatory building inspection work were indeed carried out. And also through the service owners were able to apply for our support. To be honest, it is very difficult for individual owners to do these on their own. They can't even take out a third-party risk insurance plan because they need advices on these issues. So in assessing the efficacy of BM Pass, we cannot just look at the number of OCs established. Like Mr. Lau said, owners are using services under BM Pass. We have reviewed these services in the past 9 years. According to the stakeholders, they want us to keep the service. That's why we have rolled out two additional phases of the BM Pass, and we are going to regularize it. There are still a lot of shortcomings. So in regularizing the scheme, we will change some of the performance indicators. For example, the audit report mentioned, the output indicator of the consultants will be changed when we regularize the program. Mr. Lau, just now the secretary and the director said the greatest incentive for owners to establish OCs is when they receive an order from the government, because they would be helpless without an OCs. For three new buildings, many of them have serious structural safety, fire safety, or public environment problems. When they receive a government order, they would usually track their feet, and they would be clueless as to what to do. So would the HAD intervene or discharge the duty for the owners first and then recover the cost from them later on? There are people, there are owners who are reluctant to do so themselves. For example, the Great Fire in Yau Ma Tei, they have received a lot of government orders. There were fire safety concerns, however, the owners did nothing. So maybe it is better for the governments to intervene first and then recover the costs later. As the owners, they may be concerned that about the possible recovery of costs, so they would make use of the BM Pass and sort out these issues themselves. The secretary didn't tell us the order of events, whether the departments would intervene first and then recover the cost later. So secretary, Mr. Lau's questions is relevant to paragraph 2. Like Mr. Lau said, these are just empty talks, especially for the departments. According to your reply in A2, you said it is not under your purview. It is under other departments' purview. We cannot accept this attitude. So, Mr. Lau, is this what you are asking? Yes. Thank you, Chair. So usually when I answer questions in electrical meetings, I would be answering on behalf of the government. So I would like to say on behalf of other departments, we are all working very hard on it. For example, fire safety, structural issues, and environmental issues. Let me take fire safety as an example. When I concerning old urban areas with fire hazards. It is not just a problem with three new buildings. I've just visited a building which has just had a fire. It has its own OC, and there was proper management. There are also other buildings which had fire. They were standalone buildings with single ownership. So we really need to deal with fire hazard very promptly. Electrical members ask the government to address fire safety concerns as a priority. In my opening remark, I have mentioned that the administration is considering amending the Fire Safety Buildings Ordinance to empower the FSD and the building departments to engage in fire safety improvement projects for owners of old buildings who are not capable to do so themselves, and then costs will be recovered from them. So we have heard members' views, and we will deal with the risk urgently. That is what we are doing. And we are not waiting until the end of this year. We have been helping three new buildings to comply with fire safety instructions made under CAP 577 Fire Safety Buildings Ordinance. We understand that the owners in three new buildings have some difficulties. I've been visiting these areas with electrical members. For example, the structure of the building cannot support water tank on the rooftop. So the building department would visit three new buildings where the residents have difficulties discharging the duties and provide the supports needed for them. This is an extra step taken by the building department. Like the example I gave, if a water tank has to be built, however the building cannot support it, the fire safety department has provided guidelines for relaxed requirements of water tank for older buildings with four floors or above. For such a case, the issue can be dealt with under a more lenient framework without affecting fire safety and structural safety. The period for complying with the order can be extended reasonably. So the FSD has been doing a lot to help the owners in old buildings. We understand that different buildings have different circumstances. The most important thing is to deal with issues which would pose a hazard. And also it is very, very important to conduct inspection on buildings. For buildings which are substandard, we have to help them. For owners who should be able to do it, however they choose not to, we would enforce the law. That is under the FSD and the building department's purview. According to the figures given to me by these two departments since 2007, when the ordinance took effect, some 10,000 targeted building has been inspected, and over 28,000 orders have been issued. So we have been providing help and also enforcing the law as well, or rather 280,000 orders. So we have a lot of departments, but we are working as a team. We have been using different methods to deal with the issue. Secretary, just a kind reminder, you have been to meetings in Finance Committee and have been answering our questions. The Public Accounts Committee is a bit different with other panels. The discussion is not limited to 4 minutes. It is okay if you digress. However, in PAC meeting, the more you digress, we will ask more questions. You really have to answer our questions. Even if we cannot finish the discussion in this meeting, I will have more meetings for you. So you have to answer the members' question directly. Just now, Mr. Lau's question was very simple. How does the government help the owners in free new buildings? Now, you have been talking about FSD and BD. It seems that your role is just coordination, like that of a postman. So his question was very direct. According to Gen 2, your reply, it seems that you haven't done a lot. Members are very well versed with the free new buildings problem. So on behalf of Mr. Lau, I would like to ask you to answer his question directly rather than spending a lot of time to explain it in length. It's all right, Tara. We welcome a lengthy explanation. We will just have a few more meetings because that is our duty. Mr. Lau, do you have any follow-up questions?
So I only want to understand the district office's roles. Can they have a more leading role in pushing forward the policies? So you have to help them incorporate the owner's corporation, so you can actually first do it for them and then recover the cost afterwards. So the starting point would be to help them incorporate owner's corporation, and I believe that is the most beneficial method to do it. For many free new buildings, they don't have an OCs. But we still hope they can have a good management. So as in our opening remarks, owners have the primary responsibilities and we can only help them to do it. And I think the help from other government departments is also very important. For example, they can help them to apply for different kind of support services. So we would encourage and help them to do better in managing the buildings. Mr. Lau, can you follow up on the Secretary's reply? In the opening remarks, they said out of the 6,000 buildings, they have done 2,000 out of them. Can you ask them more about how long would it take or the cost it would require for that? Maybe you can follow up now first. Actually, in 2.5 of the report, it's about the advisory scheme. Three phases take 38 million and goes on to 48 million for and beyond for more phases. So do you have the scale for the fees? So you also have replied on why is the success rate so low based on the report. So what are your solutions or change in the direction of policies in response to the recommendations? After regularizing the services, how will be the fees be changed after it get regularized? So in table 5, so the objectives for you to help incorporate OCs, so the recommendation is because the target is low, so it's easy to attain. So will you consider lifting the targets in future, so that it would be more challenging and to encourage them to achieve the target to the best? Thanks, Chair. We agree with the recommendations. So about regularizing the advisory service, we will have enhancement on that, and we also would aim for more OCs to be formed. And for the resident nation ambassadors, we hope there will be more. And also for the lead program or the training program for the management committees, we'll do more. And for the measures on the three new buildings, I think the measures are broadly effective. But how can we enhance the requirement to make it more challenging so that the success rate for improving the three new buildings can be improved? We do agree, like enhancing the requirement, lifting the target is one of the ways to do it. So after the tendering process, we would announce the prices and the results for the tendering. So this work will be done for this year. But we agree with your recommendation, we do more and we would try to achieve more. So Secretary, is there a concrete target? For example, what is the exact number of increase or enhancement for the indicators? Details are to be provided in due course. For example, in the past 10 years, we formed over 500 OCs. So these are some counter examples to be worked on. Director, I have not much further comments, but I will refer you back to the auditor's report. For example, for resident liaison office, resident liaison ambassadors, for example, per building, we aim to recruit more from each building. So the objective is still to promote formation of the OCs, so that would in turn help improve the management of buildings. So in 2.6, you said the three new buildings without OCs went down from 6,000 to 4,000. But for those three new buildings that are not eligible because of their rateable value, etc. Or for some OCs that are defunct or inactive, you don't have a database for the exact number of those ineligible or for with those buildings with defunct or inactive OCs. According to CAP 344, example, if they don't have a owner's meeting in 12 to 15 months, then they will be considered inactive. So based on the latest guidelines in CAP 344, I'm worried you miss out some OCs that are already inactive, and you'd miss out them because you don't have any ways to supervise or monitor their operation. So if you don't have anything that in your database that correspond to the data regarding the inactive OCs, I don't think you have a guideline for you to work on to identify and help those inactive OCs. I think the problem you mentioned is can be covered by the liaison officers from district offices. So they have a better grasp of the situations in the buildings. So we actually have those data. I think it's about how we update the information system. So we have that data, and after we duly update them, then we can provide the right solution for them, so that we can reduce some redundant visits and to avoid waste of resources. We can respond to you further later. But as I said, we agree with the audit recommendations and that we can do better in this area. Speaker is off mic. So with regard to your questions about the defunct or inactive OCs, we would continue to take advantage of our liaison officers' networks. So we issued their internal guideline last month, and we require the liaison officers to have a clear record for any of their visits. And we also have templates for them to follow in recording the information about the visits. So on top of all these, we also remind the liaison officers as to the key information they need to gather during their visits. And so regarding the defunct or inactive OCs, whether they should still be covered by under our advisory scheme, we would emphasize to our liaison officers to identify to ascertain the eligibility of the OCs as per the guidelines in CAP 344. So if we do identify some OCs who appear to be inactive, we would, for example, issue letters to them to confirm whether they are really inactive. For example, if they don't respond to our letters, then it may point to them being really inactive. So all these improvements and the further guidelines we issued are part of the responses to the recommendations. Thank you. So other than being just ineligible, sometimes there may be breaches of CAP 344. So for For the inactive OCs, we can expect they don't convene meetings regularly and they don't issue any financial statements for us to refer to. So what about the breaches committed by breaches of the BMO committed by those inactive OCs? Do you have any penalties or deterrent measures to keep them, to prevent them from the breaches? On that, the audit recommendations did not cover law enforcement, but on our own, we do have ways to strengthen law enforcement in regard to the BMO, because the primary direction for our measures would be to advocate and to first warn them. But on top of that, we still have plans to strengthen the law enforcement process. For example, when you look at the BMO again, it require the owners to convene meetings regularly. So with the requirements for meetings or on requirements on financial statements, we would look at the compliance with those requirements. And if the current warnings or the measures that we have already taken are not effective, then we would look at strengthening law enforcement. So escalating the measures from mere warning to penalties. So these are all possible ways for us to enhance the deterrent effect for our measures. But we don't think it's right to just prosecute them for first-time breaches, and we should still start with issuing guidelines, and if needed, we can escalate the measures from there. But currently, guidelines or checklists are still and also enhancement of our support services are still our primary measures to help them comply with the requirements under the BMO. Maybe other members can say something too. Maybe you can go table by table, and based on what you see on the table, maybe you can look at how they have achieved the target so far. Sometimes the success rate may look high, but it's actually because of a low target being set in the first place. So maybe you can look more thoroughly into those to point to public, especially to let those who are living in the three new buildings to know what they should focus on in the reports. So I'll suggest to you, for example, you can go table by table to look at the performance in greater detail. For example, again in the table, we focus on the success rate. So you maybe were informed, but maybe not so for the general public, so you may want to point more in depth to them for them to know.
Yeah,
Mr. Porter, I should say this from the start. It's many of you are representatives at the district level. You know that these are all thankless tasks. You know, in particular, in recent years, many OCs have become politicized, so it's made your work doubly hard. But then, since we have certain policy objectives and there is a piece of legislation in place, let me first ask questions about that. Just now, the secretary and the director said that when it comes to forming OCs, you provide financial support and other support services. So, the first and foremost performance target is to form as many OCs as possible and reduce the number of free new buildings. So it'll be much easier for you to take out to make sure the law is complied with. But let me first ask about that, and then later on I'm going to ask about existing OCs. Now, anyway, there's mentioned that we should review the legislature to see if we should make the penalty heavier, but we can talk about that later. Anyway, about the Phase 3 advisory service and the number of target buildings for the Phase 3 BM pass. Perhaps I don't need to go through all the figures, but then the variance is from negative 75 to 75. And then table 3 mentions buildings approached and the number of buildings which have set up OC subsequently. But you see that the success rate is really low at 40%. It's not at all satisfactory. So that's the success rate for the past three phases. And then, say, there's a selection of a particular area for household visits. I'll come to that later. Anyway, about the figures, the success rate, rather. In the past 9 years, we started with 3,820 buildings approached, but only 536 buildings ended up with the OCs formed or reactivated. So the success rate is 40%. Now, the explanation given is that there are difficulties because the buildings are aging, the occupiers are aged also, and then there are buildings with single ownership. Well, if that is the case, have you considered ways to boost the success rate? You know, because you have said it's important to set up OCs. And the consultancy, you know, are you happy with their work in the past nine years because the success rate is not really high? You know, it's 40% on average. So what more can you do better? Thank you. In the past 10 years, we have seen the number drop from some 6,000 buildings. And for buildings that would be easier to form OCs, we've already approached those buildings. And then for the remaining buildings that have not yet formed OCs, well, there are certain common problems they face, as we've explained earlier. Now, it's because the owners are old, they don't believe they have the energy or the financial resources to carry to do it. And so that's why in the past 10 years, we have various support schemes in place, as I explained in my opening remarks. For example, if they need technical support, then we will see how we could ask the professionals to help them. And if it's about lack of resources, if there are repair orders, Secretary, I haven't yet come to that part That is where there's no more room for improvement, what you can do to help the building owner, say, with repair, environmental hygiene, so on. I haven't come to that, but rather I'm focusing on the question of whether these three new buildings remain three new buildings forever. Is there no more room to work on that? Or could you actually do a bit more? For example, you can set higher targets for the consultancy. Yes, as I said, if we are going to when we regularize the BM pass, we're going to revise the targets to set them higher. And then with the three new buildings, we do offer them help too. We help them with meetings, we provide them with other support services. And as we regularize our support services, even for buildings with, you know, for other buildings, the 4,000 plus buildings, we are going to try to reduce number as far as possible. And we're going to set higher service targets. Now, in the 2019 POTS address, as mentioned, of regularizing the services, it's been 2 years since. How long would it take before you could regularize the services? Do we have to wait forever? No, we are actually preparing the tender. And during the interim, we will help still provide support to the three new buildings. Secretary, now I haven't yet come to three new buildings that could not set up, for which there could be no OCs, but rather I am still looking at table 3 and 4. Now, table 4. For District A, there are targets set. And it seems that for quite some households, you were unable to visit them. And for households you could visit, some 97% of those households were willing to accept your service. Of course, it's not true that only patriots could become members of the management committee. Anyway, for the household visits, it seems that it's a problem that you are enabled actually to visit those households. So your effort to visit those households have been unsuccessful. So how are you going to increase the success rate here? Now, for household visits, usually we try to liaise with the households through various means, like, say, calling them to make an appointment and so on. The details are spelled out in the report. So on giving guidelines to liaison officers or for the consultancy firms, how can we help, how do we require them to make sure the visits are successful and so on. So anyway, we could see from the figures that if the household visits are successful, the rate of, there's a higher success rate of OC being formed. Anyway, we will be improving communication by liaison officers and so on. Director. Now, we try to provide these advisory services at night as far as possible because, you know, OCs probably hold meetings at night, and so there's no point making household visits during work hours because people are not home usually. And for the older three new buildings, most of the occupiers are tenants. There are actually fewer and fewer owner-occupiers. We learned from the neighbors that because many of the owners are becoming older, they could not really walk up the stairs, so that's why they've moved out and they've rented out their units. So for these units occupied by tenants, you know, whether our household visits are successful or not, it wouldn't make much of a difference because we actually need to approach the owners, not the tenants, and that's where the difficulty lies. Now, from our experience, sometimes we manage to approach the owners, but they're too old, they don't really want to talk to us, and they don't know who we are, then. Next time when we invite tender for the regularized service, perhaps we have to dictate that there should be wider district-based publicity and household visits should be scheduled for the evening, perhaps. And from our experience, when we were successful in persuading building owners to form OCs was when repair orders were issued. Because usually when repair orders were issued, then owners would be more interested and very soon would be able to help them set up OCs. In fact, some owners would approach us on their own accord when they received repair orders. And then, some residents who've received repair orders, they would probably seek assistance from district councillors and the district councillors help them to extend their repair orders. So that's why we do keep in liaison with the district office, councillors, ward officers. And we ask them to refer such cases to us if they are approached. Now, it's actually not difficult to set the targets higher. But then most importantly, we want the consultants to be able to help building owners set up OCs. So we are thinking of additional incentives. For example, if you would accept our service on your own volition, then we will give you a free cleaning for the whole building or something. So we're trying to say that, okay, as long as you would use our advisory service, there's no need for consent from all owners. We provide you with certain services, so that will serve as an incentive for owners to join our scheme. Why do we do that? Ms. Wong, the Deputy Director, explained that already just now. In accordance with law, we need building owners to form owners corporations because that is the body appropriate to follow up on building management matters. But then at the moment, there are no penalties involved. And for most who are office bearers in OCs, they are volunteers. So we cannot actually impose any penalty, otherwise no one would want to become members of OCs. It's not true that we don't want to consider penalty, but if we do put in place penalties, then more people would become reluctant to become OC members. So that would be another challenge for us. Well, Mr. Chairman, you asked a good question. We always mention the need of OCs, but can we do certain things without OCs? For example, cleaning, that can be done. Now, we would actually knock on every door and tell them that we're going to help clear away all the refuse for you. If there is a thing outside your door, then we'll clear it if you don't put it away. And for buildings, of course, there are deed of mutual covenant, so it's clearly spelled out which are considered common parts of the building and which are not. And then there's another issue about legal matters. So that's why for some buildings we could work on it, but for some we couldn't. Well, Deputy Director, sorry, we need to be focused. You're going back to what you could do where there are no OCs for certain buildings that we're interested in, but it's not what we are focusing on right now. We are talking about giving assistance and support to OCs, but do we have legal, representative for the building, and that's what we're talking about. Now, if there are problems with setting up OCs, then we should amend the legislation so it would be easier to form OCs. Or you could actually send someone to become a member on the OC. You have many legal liaison officers, they could perform that role. Now, I'm not in favor of any penalties because these are voluntary members, and if you impose or include penalties, actually, it will go against the objective of helping people form OCs. Now, you've spent so much on advisory services, In para 2.11, the auditor said nicely that there is no evidence to show that the Shady's ever asked the contractors what difficulties they've encountered. Now, when you receive reports from the contractors, have you actually tried to find out whether they have tried their best and what difficulties they've encountered? If you have done such inquiries, how come there's no record on that? In para 2.15, the Audit Commission has been fair to point out the difficulties encountered. So we did try to find out about the situation from contractors, but how come there's no record? We have some records. So member asked about that. Actually, is mentioned in the next few sections of the report. That is, we now know the number of buildings and on the success rate and so on. We agree that we need to do better in terms of collecting information. For example, we should use various means to liaise with the buildings to see if they actually have an OC or has the OC become inactive or what. So we would need to find out such information. And in trying to reduce the number of new buildings, you know, there are actually various ways to help building management. In some cases, they could be really complicated. And even if for these buildings they're not able to form OCs, they could hire property management company. And that means the building is no longer a free new building. So there's one way to do it. The best way, of course, is for owners to form themselves into some sort of organization, and then they could apply for resources under the various schemes of the government. So how could we further reduce the number of free new buildings? As I said, OC is not the only way out. They could form mutual aid committee, residence committees. There are various ways to do it. And then when it comes to, say, hygiene, environmental hygiene, they could hire a property management company to help with that. So we're saying that we are using various means to help building owners better manage their buildings. Now, but if you don't ask focused questions, we'll never get the answers we need. Both the secretary and the director have been saying that we could not reduce number. You know, there are other forms of assistance, even if building owners could not form OCs and so on. No, of course, but here we are doing a value for money study. It's not about what we can help those do to help buildings who couldn't form OCs. And it's not the first year. We have spent $94 million. It's not the first year that we're doing it. We've been doing it for 9 years. So we have to ask the question, how come you have spent so much money in 9 years and the success rate is still just 40% for helping building owners to form OCs? And what you're doing is not effective, then we should consider amending legislation. Why are you giving you money and why are you paying the contractors? And still the success rate is only 40%, so is it worth it? Maybe we should not bother at all. And we don't need to require buildings to form OCs. Without OCs, they'll be given assistance. If that's the case, why bother with OCs? But here we are asking the question, how come you spend so much money, you couldn't help more buildings to form OCs? So we need to get to the crux of the matter, and then we can find a solution. And if you keep bringing in other issues, focus become blurred. But rather, the question is, if what we've been doing has not been effective, do we need to revise our policy? Well, there are actually deficiencies in CAP 344. Last time at the panel meeting, we talked about amendments to CAP 344. Now, CAP 444 came into place a long time ago. At a time for owners' corporations, it was more like a social organization. It's really not about, you know, repairing buildings or other major tasks. So that's why under CAP 344, there are restrictions on who could become chairman of a mutual aid committee and so on. So, and then CAP 344 also states that where there is not an OC, and if the government wants to intervene, then we need to first probably amend the legislation, because now in the ordinance it states that only when the situation is really dire, then the government could intervene. The government couldn't intervene just because there is no management body for the building. This is because we respect private property, so property owners have the right to decide how to manage their own properties. But then in the existing legislation, it says that if there is an immense danger, then the government could send someone in to manage the building. Thank you.
Can I follow up for Paul? In the past 9 years, during the three phases of BM Pass, $150 million have been spent. In the past 9 years, you have only engaged two consultancy firms, one for District 1, 2, 3, 5, the other for District 4 and 6. So have you reviewed whether the consultancy firms had achieved what you wanted? So many years have passed, so are they just patronizing you and pocket the money every year? And also, have you set performance targets for the consultants? Where can we find the record of these performance indicators? The issue we are talking about is for three new buildings to formulate OC. We have already spent 2 hours asking questions about that. However, we have not got a clear answer from you. So why do you still engage these two consultants in the past 2 years? How long is the term for one contract? If they are not doing a good job, you should change the consultants. Well, we engage the consultants through open tender exercise. We know each contract term is 3 years. So there have been three contracts for each of the contractors. Yes. So one consultant would be responsible for 5 areas, 1, 2, 3, 5. So did you review their work results? Have you reviewed the records with them? Because we need to consider whether the public money is well spent. Maybe Ms. Wong, the Deputy Director, can explain our review mechanism of the contract according to Table 5. Chair, for each contract term, or rather after each contract term, we would start inviting tender again. There have been three phases, so we engage the consultants through open tendering, and we have set out the output targets in Table 5. Maybe the level is not high enough, so when we regularize the program, we will raise the level of these output targets. In terms of the actual output targets, we are satisfied with the consultants' performances. Well, you may say that the output targets were set too low. That's why they have been overachieving. Well, we will review the level of the output target. We consider the consultants' performance satisfactory according to the output targets, but we will continue to improve. Did we review the performance with the consultants each time to find areas for improvement? Actually, during the contract term, we have had meetings regularly with consultants and request them to give us reports. During that period, we have consulted the users for their opinions, and also there have been users advisory meetings and also satisfaction surveys. The feedback was very positive. On the district level, there are many council members who are very well versed with building management issues. According to these members, also gave us very positive feedback as well. So with these feedback, with and also the output targets, achievements, we were satisfied with the consultant's performance. 14%, you are satisfied with that. We will continue to review and enhance the output targets in future. Before we propose to regularize the program, we have consulted some local stakeholders or members who are concerned with building management. They all supported to regularize BM Pass after the three phases. After each phase, we have reconsidered whether we should continue with the program, because this is a trial or pilot scheme. However, like the assistant director said, the feedback was positive. However, there is deficiency. When we ask the users to return the satisfaction survey, usually the feedback was positive. However, the response rate was rather low. It reflects that the users were not engaged enough after getting these services. However, from the point of view of local stakeholders and council members, they were supportive of the program. We understand the success rate of 14% is too low. We hope we can improve the performance as well. The most important thing is to ask the users to give us their feedback, even if it is negative. What we have now is just the statistics that we got. According to paragraph 2.19, the users' feedback rate is too low. Secretary? Yes, 2.19 and 2.20. I agree that we should enhance the output level, which include enhancing the successful rates of forming OCs, because that will help to reduce the number of free new buildings. How we can canvas more views? The views we receive are usually extreme, are either very supportive or very unsatisfied. However, usually these feedback was supportive. Like the director said, we should canvas more views and collect more views from users. Maybe we can do this through different ways, for example, making calls to ask the service users for their feedback. So we agree with the commissioner of all these recommendations, and also we will enhance data collection and also output level. I will quickly ask my last question. The feedback rate is very low, so we cannot rely on that figure, because many users did not give you their views. For a value for money study, we have to look at the quantum and also the quality. For quality, we have no objective measurements. What about the quantum? The first phase targets were 90, was 99, second phase was 90, the third phase was 105. So who sets these targets? Were these targets set by you for the contractor or were they suggested by these contractors? Director? When we invited tenders, these targets were printed on the tender invitation. After each phase, we have taken a tally of the successful cases and also the response, and adjusted the target a bit upward in the third phase. Thank you. You have answered my question. You said you would further review the target after regularizing the program. However, this is not the first phase. This is the third phase already in 9 years. The first tender received some 190% tender application. But the successful rate is so low, so you should have reviewed your upward targets even before the commissioner of audit's report. I understand that you may not be in this position back then. However, I would like to remind other departments as well. The overachievement rate is some 190% or 159 or 165%. But the successful rate is just 14%. And you are just conducting a review after 9 years. This demonstrates the lack of efficiency among civil servants. Well, but late is better than ever. Yes, we have heard members' concerns. That's why we are now hammering out the details for the new phase of BM Pass. We have heard members' views that the targets should be set higher. Then if we can achieve a successful rate of 80 or 90%, then it would be very good. Secretary or director, maybe you are not very familiar with the practice of PAC. Maybe you were not the responsible officers back then. In PAC's public hearing, our goal is to find the facts. It is a fact-finding committee. You have the record. You have the facts. However, we have a hard time understanding the facts that you presented us. When you are not able to address our questions, we will just ask more questions to find the truth. How about we take a 15-minute break and then we resume at 4:15. Thank you.